Hello everyone, and welcome to today's learning session, Forest Monitoring Using 3D Data from UAV SFM Technology, organized by WWF Forest and Climate. Thanks for taking the time to join us. My name is Emmeline Gasparini, and I am a Program Associate with the Forest and Climate team. Our presenter today is Akira Kato from Chiba University, Japan, and he's going to talk about some very interesting things today. So before we begin, I'd like to go over a few logistics and some frequently asked questions. For those of you who have participated in past sessions, this will, of course, be familiar, but yes, today's presentation is being recorded, and you can find the recording within a few days on our YouTube channel. To get to the recording, simply go to youtube.com and search for WWF Forest and Climate. There are two audio options. You can listen through your computer or dial in through the phone number that was provided in your registration email. It's important to note that if you experience audio difficulties while listening through your computer, those are sometimes caused by having too many browser windows or programs open at once. So feel free to close some of them, which usually solves the issue, or you are always welcome to join by phone. And if you continue to have technical difficulties, please send me a message via the chat or question function on your screen, and I'll try to get you sorted out. Questions are absolutely welcome. You can send your questions anytime during the webinar using the toolbar on your screen. We will answer as many as possible during our allotted time, and after the webinar, you'll receive a link in your follow-up email with additional forest and climate resources from WWF, including a link to the YouTube channel where you can watch a recording of this session. Thank you again for joining us, and with that, we'll get started. So Akira, take it away.
Hi, thank you very much. Thank you very much for your introduction. And hello everyone, I'm Akira Kato. I'm talking from Japan. And actually Japanese time is a morning time, so I didn't sleep well last night to prepare for these slides. So I hope you enjoy my talk and slides. And a big motivation, you know, I would like to talk about the forest monitoring using 3D data from UAV SFM. And big motivation about my research is REDD+, like as everyone knows about this. But and they have the special scheme to report the forest condition named MRV, measuring and reporting and verification. And big problem for this scheme is we don't have any common data to work together. Kind of like, you know, based on the researchers, they can choose different, like a satellite image or, you know, any remotely sensed data set. So widely accessible data is required to monitor the forest, but, you know, there is no standard scheme established yet. And low-cost data is expected to receive because, you know, REDD project, REDD plus project is for developing countries, so like the expectation is that everyone needs to access the data. Please go to the next. Okay, good. So the Google just started the Google Earth engine, and the you know researchers kind of like you know use their data archive, like a Landsat archive or Sentinel like a satellite image archive, free archive. And they created kind of like a global-based, you know, the forest like a change map from 2000 to the current. So this kind of like a map is very nice and kind of globally covered. And right now is a you know open data kit. If there is some like a smartphone-based like a technology is linked to the satellite image to go to the exact location of illegal logging. So kind of like this new technology is available right now. But still, like, you know, the Landsat base is a 30 meter by 30 meter. It's a bit coarse resolution. So we need to get more kind of detailed information of our, you know, of our forest. That is the aim of my research. Please go to the next. Okay, so Google Earth Engine is quite nice. Because when you go to their website and you just type the small kind of like a script to open the huge data archive, for example, like a bottom image, you can clearly see how powerful the Google Earth engine is. Just type like a Landsat image from, for example, like, you know, from last year, they just, you know, display the all Landsat archive data in a few seconds. So we can use Google server and also their data collection to monitor our forest. That is fine. But still, like, you know, we need to get more detail. You know, this Landsat base is fine, our Sentinel image is fine, but we need to get more detailed information of our forest. Okay, please go to the next. So what we can do for our forest is we can go to the field to start to measure the trees. But of course, you know, there is some limited measurement, kind of like a tree height, DBH, to estimate stem volume. And also, like, you know, limited samples too. We cannot measure the forest, you know, huge forest by ourselves. So we usually use some kind of like a statistical technique to estimate the entire forest based on the limited samples. And accuracy issue, that is a problem. Like, you know, human measure we can measure the forest, but of course, there is a human error associated with the measurement. That is a kind of like a, we need to deal with the issue. I mean, like, you know, we need to avoid the human error. So I want to introduce some of the 3D technique today to kind of like a, to reduce the human error. That is a topic. Okay, please go to the next. All right. So, like, you know, initially, there is a fancy technology named airborne laser, and later on the terrestrial laser is coming up, and now we can use structure from motion. The big difference among these technologies, the airborne laser is very stable and, you know, wide coverage because the laser is mounted on the like airborne vehicle and capture the 3D exactly, 3D data, like, you know, 3D forest data exactly, but it's pretty expensive. And terrestrial laser is kind of like a relatively cheaper, but still, like, you know, we have to buy the sensor and carry it to the forest. But the structure from motion is pretty cheap because we can create 3D data from just, you know, just photos. Like, we just take a photo to create the 3D data of any object. That is a huge advantage of this new technology named structure from motion. I will explain about how it works later soon. Please go to the next. Okay, so the terrestrial laser is pretty good technology. So we can carry this portable sensor to any forest and just to, you know, set the sensor underneath of the canopy and scan the forest, get the 3D data. But you know, the sample is limited because based on the location of the sensor, so when you put the sensor in a, you know, technically we have to put the several locations to combine all the data together. That is a kind of like a disadvantage of this terrestrial laser scanner. Okay, please go to the next. But you know, of course, terrestrial laser is, you know, has the advantage over the airborne laser. You can clearly see the center figure. Airborne laser can capture the, you know, shape of the tree, but we can measure the stem, you know, stem shape exactly. But terrestrial laser can measure the stem because the, you know, the terrestrial laser can scan from the underneath of the forest, so we can get more detailed shape of the stem. And UAV SFM today, you know, we are talking about, that one is kind of created from the sky because you know, camera mounted on the UAV to create the 3D data. So the detail of the canopy shape is pretty well. I mean, like, you know, we can create 3D data of the canopy is pretty well. That is a huge advantage of this UAV SFM. Please go to the next. So what is structure from motion? That is a new way to create 3D data from freehand camera data acquisition. So you only need camera to create 3D. So it costs nothing. If you only have a camera you can create 3D data from anything. That is a huge advantage of structure from motion. Please go to the next. Here are some good examples how it works. And I usually use commercial-based software named AGSoft or like Pix4D. There is a commercial software available to handle the SFM technology. So you just input the many photos taken by different angles, and they can create 3D out of them. So left upper corner, the first thing the software can do is they estimate the camera location where you took the photos. And left bottom corner, that one is point cloud data. They can convert it from 3D data to a point cloud. That one has XYZ and also color information attached to it, RGB color. And also they can create a mesh or a wireframe model too, based on this 3D point cloud. So how you take the photo is up to you. If you have many photos, you can create detailed shape of the stem, like left and right upper corner figure. You can clearly see kind of like an irregular shape of the stem, right? So if you take the many photos, you can get detail of the object. That is a kind of like the basic workflow of SFM. Please go to the next. So I want to test it some other object. For example, a nest, a bird's nest. I put onto the ground. This is an artificial nest, so don't worry about it. I didn't steal it. Just put on the ground and took the many photos to create the 3D. So kind of like this irregular shape, we can capture the shape as 3D data. So you don't need to measure the object during the fieldwork. You can take 3D data using this SFM technology, and then you can bring the data back to your office and measure in your computer. That is a good thing to do. And also the scale invariant. And so even the leaf level, needle leaf level, you can capture the shape using this technology. So, and even more like small insects, we can make the 3D out of this technology. I mean whatever the object, you can take photos, you can create 3D. That is a good thing to use the SFM. And of course, forest, huge forest, if you use a UAV and takes many photos from the sky, you can create 3D of the forest. Please go to the next. So what I'm doing right now is kind of like, it's kind of like a big project I got it. So some local kind of government asked me to take the one island kind of shape. So I asked my 10 students and went to the island and flew many UAV and took the many photos and created this one island, like a 3D data. So it's a huge data set, kind of like 50 gigabyte or something. Like it's a huge data set, but we can capture each individual tree 3D data using this technology. So scale is invariant, which means you can capture the 3D from insect level or leaf level to this island level. So we don't need to, we don't need to use any special sensor. I mean, laser sensor. If you have the UAV or kind of like a moving vehicle, you just attach the camera and take the photo to create 3D. And camera itself is very cheap, so it's very applicable technology for developing countries people. So it's well fitted to the REDD project. Okay, please go to the next. So what we can do using the UAV and SFM, just simply I want to explain here. It takes a bunch of the photo. For example, I set 1 second interval and just automatically took the many photos.
Akira, I'm not sure if it's just me, but I think I've lost your audio. Can you hear me? Oh, well, sometimes this happens even though we practice in advance. All right, I hear, have one participant. Ah, Akira, can you hear me?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, okay, so now we can hear you again. If you would go back to when you were talking about giving, setting the camera to take photos at 1 second intervals. That was the last thing we
heard. Right. You're right. That's right. That's right. 1 second interval. Yes. Yeah. Thank you for asking. And can you click on the right bottom kind of movie? Yeah, this one. So finally, just took so many photos to create this fancy 3D data. It looks, you know, airborne laser data, but it's only created from photos. That is a you know power of the SFM technology. So of course, you know, if the visibility is well enough, we can create digital terrain model, digital, you know, kind of digital ground model as well. But of course, you know, kind of like a cloud, you know, closed canopy site, we can get the ground model well. But if the, you know, stands are not so dense enough, we can get the ground model too. Please go to the next. So like, you know, for example, Agisoft, there's so many softwares, you know, commercial softwares available to create 3D data from photos. But this is just one example. You know, Agisoft, you know, PhotoScan Professional, like, you know, the demo version is free. So you can test it today. But of course, you know, demo version doesn't save your data, so you have to purchase it. But it's kind of like a cheap, like, you know, 900 or 800 or 900 US dollars for academic. So like, you know, it's not too bad. So like, what they can do is they can estimate the, you know, flight path, and also they can create digital surface model as digital terrain model, it's ground model, and also rectified photo as well. So they can create, you know, many kind of digital data, you know, from your photos and point cloud too. Please go to the next. So what I can do, you know, for the UAV thing is initially I used the old version of DJI Phantom 2. At that time, you know, we didn't have any fancy camera attached to it. So I attach the digital camera, Nikon, you know, cool pixel, it's a good kind of like a resolution. So I attached to it, and GPS also attached to it, and flew over my site. But right now, Phantom 4 is a GoPro camera, is a quality is pretty good. So we don't need to attach additional camera. We can use the, you know, the UAV drone's camera, like, you know, as it is. So just fly the drone and take the photo. Yeah. Okay, please go to the next. So the drones are safe or not? Many people ask me. And actually, drone is pretty safe right now. You know, just, you know, for example, 2 years ago, drones are not so stable, you know, at the time, but now it's pretty safe. For example, like, you know, they have the special sensor to avoid the object. So like, you know, they can automatically avoid the object not to crash. And also the automatic flight mission, you know, there is a software available to plan your flight, you know, before you fly the drone. And it's automatically planted too. So you kind of like set the region and they estimate the flight path automatically. And just push the button and drone can fly by itself. So kind of like a pretty much automatic right now. So you don't need to fly by yourself manually. That is a kind of like a, you know, the dramatic kind of like a development of drone technology right now. Please go to the next.
Oh, Akira, I think we might have lost sound again. If you can hear us, please just talk until we get reconnected. Sometimes this happens. Participants, thank you so much for your patience. We always log on, you know, 15 minutes early to make sure that the audio is working properly.
Oh, okay.
There we go. Here we are. But, okay. You know, the internet is a tricky mistress. So, Akira, you're back.
Okay. Okay, thank you. I didn't hear any response, so kind of like I got nervous. Thank you for assistance.
Of course.
Thank you. Yeah, common software is available too. So you don't need to purchase additional software to analyze your data. There is so many free software available. For example, that is a kind of a partial, kind of like a partial function is free. And if you purchase like additionally, you know, you can use a huge data to you know, to run this software. But last tool is most of the part is free. And Cloud Compare, that is another software to handle the 3D data. And that is, you know, the Cloud Compare is kind of getting common right now. I mean, become very popular right now. And many kind of like a function or a kind of additional tool is kind of quickly developing. So kind of like you can use kind of extended the tools using this Cloud Compare. And Fusion software is developed from University of Washington, and where I graduated, and my former supervisor Monica, and she's kind of leading this kind of like the Fusion software. Like, you know, she's always kind of like, you know, promotes the Fusion software. And this Fusion software is good to handle the huge data, to visualize 3D data, and also like, you know, measure the 3D data manually using the software. And our LiDAR is Andrew Hudak. You know, he's my kind of like the collaborator, and he's a Forest Services guy. And our LiDAR is the software kind of built in the our statistical software. So you can just call the our LiDAR function to create the three, you know, kind of to analyze the 3D data. And even more, and Andrew Hudak and colleague, and they developed the web LiDAR. So you just input the 3D data into the web version software to analyze your 3D data. So there are so many options to analyze your 3D data. So what I want to say here, even you get the data, like 3D data, and you don't need to worry about how to analyze it. There's so many good software already available. Okay, please go to the next. So what I can do is like this is kind of like advertise my research. In the right hand side, you know, I created kind of like a fancy computer graphic technique to lap the surface. The lapping around the, you know, discrete points to capture the shape of the irregular shape of the tree, and also estimate the crown volume or volume enclosed by the lapped surface. So left hand side used to, you know, people used to apply some of the mathematical kind of like a representation of the shape. They use a mathematical formula, try to quantify the shape. But now we can use a computer graphic technique. There is another kind of like a lapping technique named alpha shape available too. So we can use such a kind of like a computer graphic technique to quantify the object itself. All right, please go to the next.
Sometimes I'm going to blame the alignment of the satellites on this one tonight. But Akira, we lost you once again. Something about changing the slides is just way too exciting for the internet to handle today. So I will just talk until you come back.
Okay.
Here you go. Perfect. You saved me.
Okay,
thank
good.
You.
Okay.
Your turn.
Right.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. So this is a kind of another kind of like example, and we used balloon. So at the time, we didn't purchase any drone, and some of the developing countries kind of like prohibited using the drone. So in that case, we could still learn to take the data from the sky.
Oh, and once again, we're going to need a moment. Akira, I'm not sure if you can hear me, but we lost you just after you were talking about balloons being a more affordable option for developing countries, which is a...
Okay.
Oh, here we go. Of course.
Sure, sure. Yeah.
You have perfect time.
Okay, good. Can you click on the light
yes.
here?
Yes, I will.
Okay, good. Okay, great. Yeah, this is a result. Yeah, so like, you know, the balloon, we can control the balloon very well, because the wind sometimes, you know, wind is strong or wind is kind of like, you know, unpredictable. But can you get a good 3D data out?
Oh, sorry, Akira. Once again, we lost you. Let's see. We'll play this again while we wait for Akira to come back. This is really fascinating 3D reconstruction of the data that he pulled from that balloon launch. Here you go. Are you back?
Okay. Good. Yep. Okay. Please go to the next. Ah, okay. Okay. Please
All right.
go to the next.
Happy to.
All right, so just, you know, the last part of my talk is kind of review the recent kind of like papers or some interesting, you know, activities. So SFM technology, is originally like, you know, they used kind of like internet pictures, like, you know, tourists took the many photos uploaded in the internet. And they just used the tourist picture to create the buildings. That was the kind of initial, that was the initial project using the SFM. So I want to tell you, you don't need to take the photo by yourself. You can still get the photo from the internet to create 3D data. So that is a kind of like a, you know, the interesting, very interesting way to create the 3D. So big data, like, you know, now, you know, people always talk about the big data, right? So you can use big data to create 3D data too. All right, please go to the next. Can you hear me? Okay, good.
Yes,
and also, like, you know, okay, good. And also, like, you know, some of my, you know, like my colleague, he used all the photos to create 3D too. You know, some people assume, like, you know, SFM technology only, like, you know, works for the many photos, but, you know, some limited sample of the photo or some limited, you know, like photos also works too. So my colleague, he kind of created a very nice kind of like a ground topological data out of all the aerial photos kind of published by the government. So it is a nice way to see what was the ground condition at the time. But of course, this kind of all the photo only creates a topography, like not the, you know, detailed shape of the trees. So the resolution is a, you know, another issue, but still we can get the 3D out of all the photos too. Please go to the next. Yeah, and microenvironment monitoring is also another kind of like a good example. And some harsh, very cold environment and micro kind of scale shape contribute the, you know, local habitat and, you know, kind of like a for the living organism. So in that case, how to measure such a micro environment? We can do it using the SFM. So we can take the many photos and create 3D object, and we can measure any, like, you know, object using this 3D data set. Please go to the next. And this is another interesting, you know, the paper, like landslide monitoring. And we used to kind of simulate landslide from kind of like a, you know, few 5 years interval data or 3 years interval data. But this, you know, this researcher, like, you know, they took the data every month to exactly see how the rocks or how the land slided every month to see what the direction of the landslide happening. So we don't need to rely on simulation. We can exactly follow how the landslide is happening based on this multi-frequent data set. So UAV SFM, we pay, you know, it doesn't cost much, right? So we can technically fly every day. We can take the data every day. Such a kind of high frequent data change the kind of like a, you know, change the perspective, our perspective to see the kind of like a situation, you know, this kind of like a landslide monitoring or forest monitoring too. Okay, please go to the next. And sand movement, and that is another kind of interesting, you know, I thought this is very interesting because sand movement, it's always sand is moving. So nobody kind of quite quantify how much sand is accumulated or what the wind cause the effect, you know, wind influence the sand accumulation. We don't know quite well. We didn't know quite well before. But, you know, SFM, UAV SFM can take the 3D data multiple times, and then we can see how the sand is moving. And sand is not stable all the time, so we can monitor the kind of moving object too. That is kind of interesting. And please go to the next. And this is another good kind of like example, and coral reefs. In the water, like, you know, we, you know, these people didn't use a UAV. Of course, we can fly the UAV under the water, but, you know, they just took the pictures underwater condition. So they try to make the 3D data out of the ocean ground or, you know, coral reef. So this is kind of another new perspective to use the SFM technology. It's pretty interesting. So the detailed shape of the coral reef, you can make the 3D data to measure it. And another good example is the snow accumulation. So snow is always melting to miss it. So we can kind of like, we can measure exact amount of the snow at the time always because it's always melting. So we can take the snow data using the UAV SFM. This paper, you know, they used the laser, you know, terrestrial laser to measure how much thickness, you know, thickness of the snow. But of course, we can take the 3D data using the UAV SFM too. So kind of like, you know, it's a good way to use the UAV SFM. Please go to the next. So what is the pros and cons? So UAV SFM can do everything, but there is some limitation and pros and cons. I want to show you the advantage and disadvantage at the last slide. And pros is a low cost, and also you can fly many times, anytime. And it's a wide coverage, like, you know, you can fly over the huge land based on the battery. So if you purchase many batteries, technically speaking, like, you can, you know, you can cover the entire state or entire district. Like me, like, you know, I took the data over the one island for 7 days. So it's possible to do it. It's automatic. That is great. You don't need to fly by yourself. Like, you know, there is a software available, so you can fly like automatically. And scale invariant, that is good. Like, you know, any scale is kind of acceptable. The cons is we need to follow the local regulations. I know, like, you know, U.S. government restrict the drone flight. So we need to follow the, you know, we need to follow the regulations. That is a cons. And weather conditions, you know, we can fly many times, but of course we have to see the, we have to avoid strong wind to fly the UAV. And limited coverage, you know, it's kind of strange, you know, wide coverage and cons are limited coverage. But I want to, I want to say, limited coverage means they only capture the kind of top surface of the canopy for forestry application. Like, you know, the kind of like a top surface of the canopy only covered by UAV SFM. If you take the data from underneath of the forest, of course you can create complete shape of the trees, you know, 3D data of the trees, but if you only use UAV SFM, you know, some part of the trees are missing and not calibrated. And people, you know, please remember that, you know, it's data is not calibrated enough. So if you don't know the scale, so it's a kind of no scale data. Like, you know, they just put the, you know, arbitrary scale to create the 3D. So if you use GPS, and then you can georeference the 3D data. So actual measurement is a real measurement on the ground. But if you don't use the GPS, when you take the photos, it's an arbitrary scale. So you have to put additional scale on the 3D data. And limited control without GPS. So this is the kind of like, a, you know, the, we have to think like, you know, the, when you fly the drone is always controlled by GPS. So some of the tunnel or some kind of like, a, you know, the drone flight underneath of the thick canopy, the GPS, this reception of the GPS is not well enough, then we have to find something, you know, something different, kind of alternative approach to take the data.
Oh, Akira, I think we lost you once again. But we've been doing very well for the last several minutes, so I think that's great if everyone would just have a moment of patience while we wait for him to come back. I want to make sure that he... Okay, are you ready for me to go to the next slide?
Yeah, next slide. Yeah, okay. Next slide, please. Okay. Uh-huh. All right, that's all. Yeah. Thank you very much for your listening. And if you have any questions, you know, if you miss my voice and didn't understand well, please contact me anytime. I'm willing to, like, you know, answer your question and help your project. And thank you very much.
Great. Thank you, Akira. Yes, so it is our question and answer time. I do have a few questions that have been submitted by participants, but please, this is the moment for you to ask. I have a question. Do you have any, what other applications would you suggest for this kind of technology apart from forest monitoring? I know you mentioned a few at the end of your presentation, but are there other perhaps red plus applicable uses?
Oh, good. Okay. Uh-huh. Okay. Can you ask me again?
Yeah, so are there any other uses for this technology that are relevant for red plus?
Ah, good question. Well, like, you know, the again, like, you know, the it's very powerful for the LED plus because you can take the 3D data for any site, and also it's very cheap. Just the UV and just photo, you know, camera, and you can take 3D data of any site. That is a kind of like a, you know, the advantage of this technology. And also, like, you know, the crop monitoring too, like, you know, LED plus, sometimes, of course, you know, we need to deal with, like, you know, people's, like, agricultural monitoring too. So in that case, you know, crop monitoring is kind of another good application using this.
Great. Thank you. I think we might have lost you again, but it sounded like you were finishing your comment. So I will wait to make sure that you're back before I ask you the next one. Participants, I see that you're sending in really great questions, so please feel free to do so. And as always, if we run out of time and we're not able to answer any questions, then I'll coordinate with Akira to answer any that are left at the end. This next question I want to ask you is whether do you use any specific software for your automatic UAV flights?
The DJI, DJI Phantom 2, which I use for, my project right now, DJI Phantom 2, they have the special software you can download by free. You don't need to purchase additional software. The company vendor provides you the software by free.
Great. Thank you. Let's see. I want to see if I can find more software questions. So the computer processing is, do you use cloud servers to process all your data, like GEE or looks like Open Forest? Or do you use dedicated software? Do you use cloud software or dedicated software? Oh, and if you're talking, I think our connection is a little disjointed again. So we'll just wait for you to come back. And these are all really interesting questions. I'm really enjoying reading through these.
Free data.
Yeah. I'm sorry. So can you say that again? No, because we didn't hear your answer.
Sorry about that. Yeah, you need a good kind of computer. You need a good performance computer. So I usually use 32 gigabytes for RAM, RAM. So you need to purchase a good computer. And cloud-based, I didn't test it yet. I usually use a local computer. It's a good performing computer.
Okay.
If you want to know the detail, just send me an email. I can send you the detail of my computer I'm setting up.
Thank you. I'm sure that that several of our participants will be interested in this because I have a few questions about training actually. So, have any video tutorials of this process ready, or do you have plans to make any of those?
If you are interested in more, I can show you how to use the software, and no problem. So I usually don't use YouTube video or something to show you how to use the software, but like this kind of the web, web communication. If you don't mind, I can teach you directly how to use the software. Yeah. Wow. So just let me know. Yeah.
That's a very generous offer. Thank you.
Yeah.
I had someone ask specifically about PIX4D trainings. Have you taken any of those trainings? Do you have thoughts about whether those would be useful for this kind of technology?
PIX4D training. If they offer by free, or if you don't need to pay for it. Well, of course, you should join it. You should join the training. But I usually just read the manual to figure out how to use the software. And, a manual itself is some part is kind of like difficult to understand, but, most of the part is not too difficult. So I recommend you to try the manual first to try to understand. Then it's better to join the kind of like workshop or kind of training.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
So sort of a general question, switching gears a little bit. Mm-hmm. When you're creating an SFM project, are there common factors that can really determine the outcome of your results? Or are there certain key points that people need to keep in mind when they're creating a project?
Good question. Thank you for asking. I usually did some trial and error and to figure out what happened, if I made a bad 3D data. And kind of pretty much I figured out by myself, but I found it like, you know, the first step, like, you know, align the photos and of, you know, kind of like a photo alignment. Photo alignment is the first step to you need to take to create the 3D data. And photo alignment is very important. So you need to put the high quality, you know, for the photo alignment. Otherwise, you cannot align the photo very well to create 3D. So kind of like a, you know, you make it kind of like a bad, you make it kind of bad quality if you don't set up the high quality for the first step for photo alignment. That is a kind of like a, you know, the key to do it. Yeah.
Ah, that's a good point. So do you have any examples of biomass estimates derived from these types of data sets?
Oh, yeah. You know, they usually use 3D data from airborne laser or terrestrial laser, and I created kind of like an algorithm or software by myself. So pretty much same kind of technique we can apply to biomass estimate, you know, to estimate the biomass, especially like, you know, biomass is strongly related with stem volume. So if you can measure stem volume very well, then you can estimate the biomass very well too, because the stem contains the most of the kind of like a biomass. So the, you know, just to measure the kind of like a diameter of the stem at the different height of the, you know, different height of the tree, then kind of accumulate of the amount of the stem volume that is strongly related with the full biomass. So that is a, you know, that I usually take the approach to do it.
Okay, and have you used data that you've collected through SFM in scientific articles?
Not scientific article yet. But I tested by myself, like, you know, from the ground, you know, you don't need to use a UAV for that case. Just, you know, walking around the stem to take the many, many data using the camera. And in that case, you can get more detailed shape of the stem, which is related with biomass. So it's better to take the, you know, photos on the ground, not from the sky. That is a, you know, I think that is my suggestion.
Okay. I have a question about illegal logging. So can you tell us how this technology is different from other remote sensing technologies in terms of detecting illegal logging?
Yeah, good question. Actually, I'm currently working for that. And I took some multiple fly, you know, I took the UAV many times to see the difference. Like, you know, illegal logging case, the obviously, like, you know, one big tree is missing, or, you know, several trees are missing in middle in the forest. So if you can create 3D surface out of UAV SFM data, 3D data, you can just differentiate among the multi-temporal data to detect exact location of the illegal logging. I think that is the finest resolution result, I don't know, out of many remotely sensed data set, I guess.
Okay. And can you use structure from motion with video as well, or do they need to be still images?
Ah, good question too. Like, you know, video image is, you know, you can easily take the video image, but the quality of the video itself is sometimes not so good. Probably many of you know, like, you know, video, and they are composed by the many, many photos. So they took the many, many photos to create the movie. So you need to divide the single photo out of movie. In that case, most of the, you know, movie, if you don't get the data well enough, it's kind of blah, kind of like, you know, it's not a good quality. So I highly recommend you to interval shot of the photo rather than movie or recording.
Okay, so it still seems to be better at the moment than video.
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
And I've had a few questions about software, a few more software questions. Would you recommend any open source software, or do you know of any open source software that would be helpful?
Yeah, there is a visual SFM, like, you know, it is an open source kind of SFM named visual SFM software available. And also, like, the Bandra, it is called, and the software name Bandra, B-U-N-D-L-E-R, Bandra, also can deal with, you know, this kind of, like, you know, same technology.
Okay.
They are all open source.
Okay, that's fantastic. And I should warn you that we're getting a lot of email addresses submitted here through the question function, so I think you're going to have a lot of people sending you emails asking you additional questions.
Okay. Sure.
But I'll ask you another here, which is, how can this technology be used for sustainable farming?
Ah, sustainable farming. Well, like, you know, the definition of the sustainable farming, you know, depends on the definition of the sustainability, but maybe, like, you know, the same things for the forestry, like, you know, how fast of the cycle, like, you know, we can monitor using this technology, because you can take the data anytime, which means you can take the data technically every day, right? So which means you can exactly, like, you know, capture how often, like, you know, how often you need to harvest, or how often you need to replant, or, you know, you can see the cycle of the farming. So that is a probably, like, a good contribution using this technology, I guess.
Okay, and I just had a clarifying question here. Did you say that the picture could be geo-referenced before making a 3D model?
No. Actually, like, you know, you just do hand-free pictures works too. So you don't need to use a geo-referenced picture. You just do, you know, take the data to create the 3D. That is fine. Without any, like, GPS information, that is fine. But of course, as I said, if you don't use the GPS, then there's no scale. So you have to put additional kind of scale. Like, you know, here to there is a 1 meter or 1 feet. Additionally, you have to add the scale to the 3D data later on after you created 3D model.
Okay. And can the resolution from the 3D models allow users to identify different forest types?
Oh, yeah. You mean like a species or something?
The question just says forest type, so I'm not sure if they had a more specific definition.
Like shrub or forest type, right? Maybe like a, you know, the, like, you know, the upper canopy or lower canopy, maybe. I think so. Like, if you use a high resolution camera, you can differentiate the different height of the vegetation too. So, like, you know, the pretty much, you know, based on the quality of the camera. So if you use a fine resolution, you can create 3D in the fine scale too. Yeah, that is, you know, that is the answer based on my experience.
Great, that's very interesting. So participants, we have a few more. Oh, good. Following up on that question that just asked, so you can can you identify species as well?
Ah, good question. It's not easy. I mean, like, you know, if you can identify the species just using the color information, that seems very easy. So I try to do it right now, but it's a bit difficult. But if you use near infrared photos, you know, maybe you can get a much better result for species identification. So some of the digital camera, you can change it to a near-infrared camera, or, you know, there is a compact near-infrared camera available right now. So you can just use that kind of, like, a, you know, wavelengths, and maybe you can classify the species too.
Okay. And do you have any software that you use to automate some of the post-analysis, such as determining species types?
Ah, Well. I don't have any software for it. But you know, there is some like open source hyperspectral, you know, kind of like image analysis software is available, and I can't remember the name of it. But you know, please send me an email. I can send you the link later. But there is a kind of like a good hyperspectral kind of like a analysis software available. So if you use hyperspectral software, then probably you can deal with the species identification too. That's I guess. Yeah.
Great. And just for participants to know, in the follow-up email that you'll get about an hour after the webinar finishes, I've made sure that Akira's email address is in there. So if you're wanting to send him questions that we don't get to, or you think of other questions, his email address will be in that email to you. And I have another follow-up question based on your last answer, which is, can you do some of this post-analysis in QGIS?
Ah, QGIS. Well. Of course, you know, I show you some of the 3D software, like, you know, Last Tools or Fusion software. There is a built-in kind of like a function to use a QGIS. So if you want to kind of analyze 3D data using such a free source, kind of like a open source, like a 3D software, you can use a built-in kind of like a function from Fusion software or Fusion software or like, you know, the 3D, you know, free 3D software. You know, I listed up on my slides, so please go back and see the name of the software again.
Yes, and we will post a PDF of the slides in the YouTube video description once the recording of the webinar is launched, probably tomorrow, perhaps the next day. And I have one last question. Okay. So you showed us that map of the island that you scanned, and I'm wondering, do you have any idea how many images you took and analyzed to make that map?
Oh my goodness, you know, that is a 2.8 like square kilometer, like, you know, wide island, and we took so many pictures, and I didn't count the number of the pictures, but you know, 7 days we spent to cover the entire island, and the picture itself, I think that, you know, 100 gigabytes or something, like, you know, it's a huge data set. So, you know, just processing the data, we took a month to process the data. So you need to think the kind of like a, if you have the huge data set, you need to take the days to proceed the data too.
Right. Wow. Well, that's very impressive.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So it looks like we've come to the end of our time today. So I want to thank you, Akira, for sharing your expertise with our community. As you can tell from the questions, people are very interested in this topic, and I'm sure you will be getting quite a few emails based on this webinar. Thank you to the participants for sending in your really interesting questions. You'll all receive that follow-up email in a few hours with some additional resources and, most importantly, Akira's email address. So if you want to revisit this webinar or share it with colleagues, the recording will be up on the Forest and Climate YouTube channel in about a day or so, and you can also find recordings of previous sessions there for additional enrichment. Thank you again for joining us, and we hope you all have a wonderful day.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Good night.